episode.
I gotta tell my mom I'm gonna be fucking yelling.
God damn it!
If anything, DLC is our fourth presenter because he's fucking fumbling it all.
Damn, look at top of me thick!
Yay!
Welcome back, ladies and gents. We're here with the third installment of our watch-along series. Not to be confused with the randomly generated Thomas watch-along. But this time, we're watching mid-releases, I guess? What do we got here for us, Percy? What do we got?
Well, we got Make Someone Happy and Other Thomas Adventures.
Alright.
James learns a lesson in other Thomas adventures.
Alright, I'm out.
And lastly, new friends for Thomas and other adventures.
Alright, I'm back.
Which one are we starting with today? I was going to say, James learns a lesson. It's been the butt end of the joke for a while. I think it's about time we actually sit down and watch it.
So to everybody, so James learns a lesson has kind of been a running joke between me and the guys here. Thing is that every time I go to any thrift store, it seems, I will always find a copy of James Learns a Lesson either on VHS or DVD. And pretty much as of now, I have every variant there is of it.
Shouldn't there be another variant that's even stronger? And then another variant? And then another one? More variants! More variants! Endless fucking variants!
It doesn't help either that they keep constantly re-releasing them.
So it's a similar situation to one of the previous ones we watched, which was Thomas the Snowy Surprise.
Link in the description.
I'd say let's just jump into it.
That's much too early. Prepare to fast forward.
Preparing to fast forward.
Fast forward.
Fast forwarding, sir.
James was enjoying his life on the island of Sodor.
Ringo.
I'm not the hugest fan of Ringo. I don't hate him. But, like, I don't know.
I think he works fine for, like, one.
Yeah.
That's not a shower. That's steam. Steam from the steam hats we're having.
Bald!
Yes! Maybe that's the fat controller behind.
No, it's Mr. Loam.
Hey guys, it's Mr. Loam.
Also behind the scenes picture right here. Also, there's another thing that I don't like about the Ringo US ones. Is you can tell exactly where the new audio is.
Hello, James, said Thomas. Feeling better? That's right. Oh, that's my conductor's whistle. I must go.
Runaway train that is smashed in the tar wagons of Marin.
Boom. Wait, is this the one with the bootlace?
Yes.
I forgot this episode was the one with the bootlace.
Well, that's the thing. It's two stories fused into one.
James in the top hat and James in the bootlace, yeah.
I do like James's theme, though. It's always great.
James's theme from series one is an absolute bop. As a kid, I always thought this was just Annie and Clarabelle.
Me too.
And that's probably what they did.
The brakes are hauled on. Leak in the pipe, most likely.
Somebody fast forward! There's no time!
That was meh.
We're up to a bang-up start, aren't we?
Oh, I like this one. Why
did I go so okay, this is gonna sound like a silly question, but what do you think they made those tears out of?
Blood.
Also, I thought that was a reuse shot, but it's not. To people who complain Thomas being shoehorned in the hit era and everything, it's been going on for a long time, you know?
I love this variant of James's theme.
Oh, I do too.
I'm doing it.
Oh, no, you don't!
The conductor stopped the cars and got out to warn a...
Oh, he was standing right there. Shit, I thought was edit that the same made. Oh, God.
I can see the string. Look at that. Did you see that?
Oh, God, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, God.
Then James saw Sir Topham Hatt. Oh, dear.
Whoa, I didn't like that. You could tell what the changes were.
Oh my god, I didn't realize how boring this was.
Boring?
Do you see why I don't like finding this at thrift stores?
This episode so badly wants to be Thomas and the Trucks. So fucking badly, but doesn't know what made that good.
James and the Express.
That's a whole bit. It's like a whole new recorded. So apparently, from what I can gather, they recorded all of 1 and 2 with the changes, but some of the ones that didn't appear in Shine Time are kind of just lost now. And before the Lost Media Wiki gets in a mess, they probably don't exist anymore.
God, that shot lasted, like, at least a good 30 seconds, I'd like to believe.
That was 40 seconds.
Hey, you know what? Credit where it's due. It's a nice long take, you know? It's nearly
time for the express. The gang on Gordon, they just want to get the group photo.
James went to get Gordon's coaches. They were all
keep going!
See that? And that would be, you went too far, now you gotta go back!
Did you lose your way, Gordon? Said James.
Also, again, I'm sorry, Carlin's delivery is so much better, so much more mocking, and I love it.
Perhaps it was instinct, said James.
Perhaps it was instinct, said James.
Can we make James Learns a Lesson speedrun?
Yeah.
Come on, backwards long jump. Let's go, let's go.
Well done, he said. Would you like to pull the express sometimes? Yes, please.
It's a philosophy that is destructive. Satan comes and disguises himself like an angel of light. I'm here to help you.
And then we got this boring ass episode.
Oh god, my least favorite series one episode.
See, my problem that I have with Thomas and the Guard is the fact that, like, yes, it establishes things for the branch line, but this is a TV show. You could basically sum that up in a sentence. You don't need a whole episode like this.
My whole problem with series one is that a lot of episodes are like James and the Express and this one, Thomas of the Guard, is like, they're boring, but the thing is, you can't really complain because it's the first series.
Mr. Angry Eyes!
I like to think that Annie and Clarabelle actually like Mr. Potato Head and how their eyes work.
Well, you just replace them.
Yeah, they're just like little pins at the back. Thomas started so quickly that he left him behind. And didn't we do this like a few episodes ago? We all make
mistakes, replied the conductor. Also, the lollipop is more interesting than this episode.
That's not even a fair comparison. That lollipop is great.
How much do you have in the lollipop anyways?
Quite a lot.
How big is it?
Well, okay, why did you think to eat a lollipop before we started recording?
He's hungry. Cut him some slack.
But it's the longest food to eat!
Why did you let me eat it? Why?
I hope you're recording this.
Yes, I do. I have.
Good.
Good.
What better way to get out of the heat than sucking on lollipops?
Annie and Clarabelle were so pleased to have their
conductor. Come on! Hurry up!
That felt like 10 minutes. Oh my god.
That felt like a hit error episode.
Oh, it does! When
Thomas puffed, so an actual good episode, finally.
Yeah, finally, Thomas goes fishing.
AKA the episode that is not available anywhere except for Amazon Prime.
Or the Carlin version.
Yep.
Piss.
Okay, I have a simple question. Are you telling me that somehow they didn't notice the wriggling fish in the bucketfuls that they put into the tank?
Well, I mean, it's like muddy water, or like foggy or whatever.
But they would have been, well, those fish would have been slapping each other inside a bucket.
I know this sounds very, very grim. Would the human equivalent of this be a tapeworm?
Ew.
Or some sort of parasite, yeah. Also, Percy's face.
Put that on the bucket. It's the thing.
The face. No, sir, I won't, said Thomas. As a kid, I didn't know that sliding was at Farquhar.
Yeah, definitely.
Farquhar isn't really in the shot too much.
Wow, I actually felt something watching that.
Yeah, like it's so far, it's actually good.
Autumn had come to the island of Zodor.
Yeah, fun fact, for the US one, it's literally one line change.
Wow.
Yeah, it's only in the beginning and that's it.
Unfortunately, guys, I'm sick of this episode, so...
Explain, please.
I don't know what it is. I've just seen this episode too many times. You'll need
your snowplow. I will say this, I feel like this is like quintessential Thomas.
Snow is. It is.
Like, if you said to someone, hey, this is what Thomas is, I would show this.
That episode for me would personally for me be down the mine.
Oh, me too, yeah.
That was the truck.
I mean, we'll say season one winter actually looks pretty good.
It looks like a Christmas Thomas. Card, is basically what it looks like.
It does. I like Thomas's winter theme in this episode. Mwah. Yeah. Terrence just kisses Annie.
Yeah, nice Terrence gets all the bitches.
Thomas, help us! We're getting taken away!
Shut up!
Oh, I just saw Annie and Crabbo in the tunnel. Oh my god. But there they are.
Yeah, you're just gonna smash right into him.
I like to think that the way Thomas got all that snow off is similar to how he got the snow off from Missing Christmas Tree.
Terrence reminds me of a dog.
Do you want to give him
a chance? Yeah, he does. He does.
Like walking around. Too.
But let me ask, did we need another Terrence episode? Yeah, in the CGI era?
No!
Well, CGI is shit.
It's the famous episode.
That iconic race episode that everyone's talking about.
Everyone remembers the story where Thomas races the bus. Who are you?
I mean, I think we can all agree. This needed and is rightfully deserved on 10 Years of Thomas.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. One of my favorite things from Series 1. I love Bertie's theme.
Also, I can never take this episode seriously because I keep thinking of Cartoon Lover 98's Thomas and Bertie's Drag Race.
He plunged into the sea, leaving Bertie farting in the toilet.
And also the fact they had a car going by in the background, too.
It's a nice touch. I'm wondering, my guess is probably like a flatbed. But he felt better
after a drink. I like to think when the engines have a drink, it just takes their mind off everything.
I mean, yeah, it basically is beer.
Beer!
Now, I love that shot.
Yes, fuck boy.
Right.
That was James Learns a Lesson. That was boring.
Yeah.
What did you say?
It was unbelievable. Like, here's the thing, right, is that it takes you, like, 4 episodes just to get to the 3 good ones.
Exactly. The episodes themselves, like, I understand their significance, but Jesus Christ, like, some of them take forever to, like, get to the point. Like, James and the Express and Thomas and the Guard are just so painfully dull.
Don't waste my bloody time!
And then you have, like, Foolish Freight Cars or Charleston Trucks or whatever the fuck, where it basically wants to be Thomas and the Trucks so badly. But at the same time, like I said earlier, doesn't know how to do it. And then you have, like, Proud Day for James, which only has one line delivery, and then the episode's just... eh. I could skip the James episodes and not miss anything, to be honest with you.
Exactly. Like, James and the Coaches, boring. Troublesome Trucks. Honestly, Troublesome Trucks isn't as good as many people make it out to be, honestly.
Wait, people say it's actually that good?
Yeah, Troublesome Trucks is, like, in quite a high regard.
Why?
I don't know, because, like, I guess James's arc or something like that.
Yeah, speaking of which, let's address it. The thing is, and it's been said a few times, Trevor and Audrey has said that James the Red Engine is his least favorite book because he feels that he was rushed. And you know what? That comes across both in writing and in episode form, because I'm sorry, these episodes are just like revisions of Thomas the Tank Engine stories. Again, they're not horrible, but they're just dull. They're
Wait
just
a minute, you just gave me a realization now. Because like, Proud Day for James is literally Thomas's train. Foolish Freight Cars is Thomas and the Trucks. Oh my god.
Learns a Lesson is more so Thomas's train. And yeah. Then, like, Thomas Saves the Day is supposed to be Proud Day for James.
James the Express, yeah. And then the others, like, Thomas and the Guard, that just feels like a hit error episode. And then the only, like, good ones are, like, Thomas Goes Fisting, Thomas Trench in the Snow, and Thomas and Bertie. Honestly, like, what rewatching Thomas and Bertie, I liked it even more because, well, it had a good pace.
That's the thing. It goes to show the importance of not stretching out the beginning with bullshit we don't need to hear.
I hate that I don't have commentary for this. I'm just watching it.
What do you think of it so far? Where do you think it's gonna go?
I don't know. It's just, it's like, it's
the problem. It's just there.
It's a little slow for a kid's movie about
Thomas the Train.
Like, Thomas and Bertie get straight to the point.
Thomas was waiting at the junction when a bus arrived. Boom, right in.
Right.
Exactly.
And like, and then you have like Thomas and the Guard, which it's like, it has to establish
things. When Thomas puffs along, he says, "Do come along, we're rather late." And they say, "We're coming along."
Give it me shit.
And that's like probably from the actual book itself. That's the sad part about it.
They're all probably like one for one from the source material.
The reason why Thomas and the Guard exists is because they wanted more Thomas episodes.
They wouldn't have adapted it otherwise, no.
Again, like I said, when we're watching it, it just feels like Thomas's train all over again.
So, I'd rank this below Percy's Aids today.
I'm gonna put it underneath Steamies vs. Diesels, honestly. I'd give it a 2.5 out of 10. I'm gonna be that harsh.
Also, thank you for doing that so I didn't seem biased.
I wanna be the outlier here, okay? I'm gonna put this above Steamies vs. Diesels. Because the episodes themselves, although boring, at least is classic. The reason why it's below Snowy Surprise is just because, well, the variety.
Snowy Surprise has variety. The problem with James Learns a Lesson is, I know I really can't say too many duds about it because it's the second release ever, but it's the problem that a lot of releases have, and that is episodic order.
And also, another problem that I have with it is that Learns a Lesson was reproduced in 2005, or like around the early 2000s. and not gets tricked. So this is the only Ringo release you could technically get on DVD at the time.
I think that's the problem with Thomas Gets Tricked and James Learns a Lesson is for the fact that the only two Ringo releases that they reissued, and for the fact that all the rest of it is Carlin, Baldwin, and Brandon, people are going to look at this release and be like, who's this? It's right. Sort of alienating.
Yeah, it's just so weird.
You two out of 10, what would you say to this release?
I guess at a 4.5 out of 10. Jesus. Hear me out. Yes, huh? They are boring, but they are charming. This is a release that I wouldn't, like, say, this isn't an essential one, but it's a neat one.
That's a fair stance to have.
Yes.
Even if you ask me too, it doesn't exactly stack up to Thomas Gets Tricked.
Because Thomas Gets Tricked is the definitive. If you're watching Thomas, or, like, that's the first exposure, that's, like, the best way of experiencing it.
It's the essential starter.
You meet the core five. It's a quintessential, and it has everything you could want. James Learns a Lesson just has James and Thomas, and the James stories are just kind of, are just really, really dull. There's nothing much to come back to. I guess I'll give it, I'll give it a 5 out of 10. It's so middle, I can't really...
You can't hate it, that's
like
the thing.
Exactly, I can't hate it because it's the second, like I said, it's one of the first few releases, and I can't really fault it for what it is. But honestly, I can't bring myself to really hate it that much. So even though, like I said, I still give it a 2.5 and it's under Steamies versus Diesels, but I'd still watch it above Chocolate Crunch because, like, it's series one. It just kind of, it feels like Thomas I'm watching.
Yeah, I've changed what I said. I'd say I'd put it under Snowy Surprise.
Next one is quite an infamous release.
New Friends for Thomas.
If you're somehow living under a rock and don't know the significance of this, long story short, Michael Angelis narrated it. That's all you need to know.
As a kid, I kind of always was always weirded out by this one because of the fact that it was Angelis and not Brandon.
I never grew up with this one.
And of course, Gianluca sort of grew up with this one, so...
Yeah, because UK. It was a sunny
day on the island of... God, look how much different it is compared to one.
I know, right?
Such a good step up, I know. After Gordon
had been washed and polished, he rushed away. There's something so comforting about Angelus.
So let's address this. Angelus is probably the best Thomas narrator, period. I mean, he's held the job for the longest. I mean,
he's gotta
come for something. Gordon
soon found out. I think the reason why he got a lot of slack was because of this and the hit era.
Yeah, yes, for whatever reason, he's significantly more... Mrs. Spencer,
he's zoned out. Yeah. In the
world. Okay, here's the thing. In Series 7, as much as he doesn't sound as enthusiastic, he still has his moments. Don't forget the water.
Who cares? Actually, I have a story with this episode.
All right, go on, share it to the class.
When I saw it on Nick Jr. on TV, this episode was aired in a four-episode block with Duncan Duncan, Rusty Saves the Day, and Fozzie Whistles. I always skipped Rusty Saves the Day. I loved watching Duncan Duncan and Fozzie Whistles, and then after Fozzie Whistles, it was Gordon and Spencer.
That's a solid lineup of episodes.
Series 1 footage.
I mean, it's not as bad as certain... bits.
But just you can...
Yeah, it's not the worst of the stock footage.
Right, but it still is like grimy looking, like, ew, that's not right. Well, oh, he's wearing his cracked jacket again, look at it!
Ah! That thing never goes away.
Yay, name boards.
We mentioned nothing in that episode, oh my god. we did a little bit,
it's
but...
fantastic! It's a great episode.
It really is, though, yes. Here we go.
That's
a good one.
Oh, this one's good. Thomas was taking
Annie and Clarabelle back to... Those are Annie and Clarabelle. A new
engine. On the wiki. Hello
to you. Wait, I just realized Emily looks like Fergus.
Oh god. Yes. The big wheel and everything. Emily's Series 7 theme is great.
Then. Oh, I just realized that tunnel's lifted up.
You know why that happened, right?
Diesel 10.
Thanks, Magic Railroad. Sorry, folks, we're not the biggest fans of Magic Railroad up here.
It's just okay.
It sucks. Emily, so that's why he looked cross, exclaimed Emily. It always fascinated me how Emily had a Scottish accent.
See, I like that, but then you find out that the Sterling single isn't Scottish. So I thought that was the case. I'm like, oh.
They're taking liberties, shut up.
Emily was still
also, hey, they recreated that shot for the Series 11 roll call.
Later, Sir Tom.
Later, Oliver. He's pissed. He's like, well, I want to die. New
coach. Do we ever see these coaches again?
Every single moment of the rest of Emily's appearances.
Yeah, that was good. I like that.
Yeah. Yeah, no. Episode. Very good episode. Right, third episode. Hey, it's Doc.
Let's Doc.
Thomas and Percy looked
at... They probably filmed at the same time Gordon Spencer, because it's the same station.
Yes, it is.
Yeah?
Freight cars. Oh god, his pupils are so big.
I was going to say, Arthur's eyes are huge. Have the freight car
started to sing. Oh, you can hear that cut there.
I want to see how many changes there actually are in this.
Soon the freight car started singing again. Stop singing, huffed Arthur. Freight cars should do as they are told.
When you realize when Michael Brandon did this, he just said trucks.
If they couldn't sing,
trucks should do as they are told. The troublesome trucks were cross.
I think that was during the PBS sessions where like stuff was just hastily translated. Because remember, they called Fergus Breaks the Rules by its UK title in that.
That truck's dead now.
All of them are.
It's just the same in between her. It's just.
Harvey arrived with the break. Also, yeah, Harvey. Remember, we only see Harvey in two episodes in Series 6. That evening,
Arthur was having the squad. Oh, yeah, he didn't whistle at Duck. That must mean they're enemies. Bullshit. Agreed.
That one was alright.
Well, that one was alright.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Reuse shots. Sir Topham Hat brought that new flat orange doesn't look good. Heavy
workload. Oh god, yeah. Oh god, it looks. Ahoy,
Murdoch! So as a kid, my dad would constantly quote Salty there, and he said that because Murdoch is one of the guys from the A-Team. Oh hey, there's the pipe from Minnesota. And if you notice, the pipe doesn't even connect all the way over; it just stops somewhere there. But
Salty and Harvey. Oh look, it's the five new engines all together
in the shed. Yeah. Hey! We're only being friendly, Mikey. I always thought with it, the way Angela said it, like, we're only being friendly, Mikey. I always thought he said Maggie. We're only
Maggie? Being friendly, Maggie? Maggie Smith?
We're only being friendly, Maggie Thatcher.
Margaret Thatcher.
Murdoch.
Murdoch Thatcher? Murdoch
was very unhappy. As a kid, I thought this lasted longer than it should.
Is this the Thomas and the Guard for this release?
Look, as an adult, I think this went on longer than it should.
Please stop.
Me watching this.
Me, just fucking run them over, Murdoch.
Actually, Toby can shove them out of the way. He is a cow catcher. He legally can.
He can legally kill a sheep.
What, Toby?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, it's a cow catcher, so I guess he can't shove him out of the way.
Well, he can get a lamb catcher.
Well, Henrietta can, yeah.
Oh, yeah, right.
See, you know what's funny? Is that in this episode, Murdoch only interacts with Series 6 characters.
Yeah. God, that episode. That's a dud.
Yeah.
It was a Whoa! I love this one! I love this episode.
Finally, the good Series 6.
And Angelus is finally back and sounding great! You may or may not want to cut this out, but also, did you ever notice how Miss Jenny has big jugs and wide-ass hips?
Well, those hips don't lie.
How many kids does she have?
No, the pack is her kids!
Is that your mum? I told her not to come and pick me up. She's fit!
Yeah, I'd fuck her.
Thanks very much.
She gave birth to Jack and Alfie, okay? It was a miracle of life.
She had a bit of trouble with giving Ned. The problem is the clap of her ass cheeks keeps alerting the pack.
She has a real dump truck, if you know what I mean.
Why else do you think Max has a big dump truck?
She had sex with a cement mixer.
Can you imagine how grim that'll be, watching that bulldozer getting squeezed out of her ass?
The foreman introduced Jack to his oiler.
Okay, yeah, here's a change I can never get behind. Why do you change Banksman to Oiler? And but here's the funny thing too, they're referring to him as Oilers in this, but in Jack and the Sodor Construction Company, they refer to it as Operator in America.
Our operators, declared Ned. They're in charge of safety.
More help means more death. More death means more fun.
I'm out. Alfie's so chubby.
Okay, you know what? I'm gonna make a controversial statement. I think Baldwin did that slightly better.
More help means more dirt. More dirt means more fun. I'm Alfie.
As a kid, This scene scared me.
Oh, me too. That perfect 180 and just Max with that big ass smile on his face. I love Oliver. Oh, hey, that's cool, Rock.
Oh, and the scene where Jack tumbled like that scared me as well.
In all seriousness, good episode.
Yes.
I loved this one as a kid as well.
Hey, good two-parter. I'm never going to complain about a good two-parter. I don't know about you guys.
Yeah. Yes.
The pack is great.
Also, I just wish we had the rushes for this because, I'm sorry, just watching these machines just operate, they're so impressive props, man. They're so,
I know, right?
So fluent, so animated, so lively. I love it.
Everyone and their grandmother compares Jack and the Pack to Bob, but let me hear you with this. Jim Henson's construction site. This is what this reminds me of. It uses the same technology as Jack and the Pack.
Yes. Yep.
And also it's a good show as well.
Yes.
But here's the thing though, is that like Bob the Builder, I mean, it's stylized. That's the biggest thing. Like, I understand Hit being narrow-minded, but like, did Hit not see how well these toys sold?
I'm kind of glad that they still kind of kept the Pack as they kept going because, on a marketing standpoint as well, because, you know, if Bob shows anything, kids love like construction vehicle based toys.
Something I was going to mention is that the only way you can get the Baldwin done with this is on Mud Glorious Mud, sadly.
Also, every time I feel Jack right here, just that lift. I know.
Like, that's what I loved about this. The weight feels real.
It's present. It's definitely present. Hold on, Jack or Kelly, and he rushed to help. But Kelly, what are you gonna do?
And the piece de resistance.
Oh,
that is so satisfying. I
think so. His hair.
Spot on. Even the dog.
I love the derpy-eyed dog. I love. So we just revved his engine and bounced his bucket. It's just so matter of fact.
Oh, yeah. that was fantastic. I loved that episode.
Oh, this build-up is just perfect. And that perfect shot to start with. I love this.
Five new engines in this. Yeah, it's great.
I'm legit getting goosebumps right now. Yeah, they picked just some of the most beautiful shots to use for this, man.
Even that one looks good. Seriously.
Yeah.
No, Gru.
There are five new engines in the shed. Take a look at these trains I just bought.
Minions?
Five new minions in the shed.
Gru, why'd you buy all these fucking minions?
Because there are five of them.
I need to make money.
All right, it's the sludge-filled tenders.
Oh, the stretched. New name boards?
Wow.
Oh, wait, that was shot during Futures for Thomas because Thomas and Percy were sitting in that spot.
Arthur was probably a coach there. Oh my god. New friends for Thomas.
Top of the list.
Yeah, straight away. That is a great release, honestly.
I mean, hey, only one dud amongst five other solid episodes. And a banging tune to cap it off. I mean, what more can you ask for?
Five Nights in the Shed is all right.
Five Nights at the Shed, yeah.
Five Nights at the Shed.
Is this where you wanna be?
I'm not gonna be honest. I'm gonna give this a 7 out of 10. It's that good.
I'd say 5 out of 5.
7.5. Just because of Peace and Quiet, bringing it down just a little bit.
Yeah, Peace and Quiet is the only one that kind of like is the dud.
And even though these are great episodes, these aren't quite all-time classics.
Yeah.
They're just really great episodes is what they are.
I think the only real issue that we kind of decided to put New Friends for Thomas here is because, well, every episode is like new engine, new engine, new engine, new engine, new characters.
And I think this also kind of belonged here just because of, I think, at the time, critical reception.
Yes.
Considering that clearly the audience didn't take to Michelangelo's. The problem is that this just wasn't like the one, I think, to start with to give the world what Michelangelo's can do.
I think the problem with trying to rank this, as much as we're trying not to talk about the narration as much, it's hard to really talk about New Friends for Thomas without mentioning Michelangelo's.
Yeah. Because that's really what makes it so infamous.
My problem with it, besides the whole narration situation, is the fact that this release is the only release to have the new characters. Meaning that as the releases go on, you're not looking forward to new characters.
I mean, at least Percy Saves the Day gave Arthur his second episode.
Thomas and the Really Brave Avengers gave us Fergus, and Hooray for Thomas gave us a little bit more of Murdoch in Best Dressed Engine.
And then Emily was the only one who kind of just got lucky enough to be sporadic, if anything.
Also, I was going to say was, like, with the Jack and the Pack episodes, you can't split them up. I know the UK did.
Hell, a Mud Glorious Mud did even.
Yes, too. And, yes. Like, the fact that that's the only way you can get the Baldwin one of Friend in Need, which then again, you're not missing much, to be honest with you.
We have to cover it eventually, I think.
And also, like, Jack Jumps In, again, that's another one that I never saw. Like, that's the weird thing about this releases, is that I never grew up with it. But I saw it. I don't know if I had a friend who had it, or like I went to like a train museum and like saw it on TV. I don't remember.
See, as a kid, I was always under the impression that, oh, maybe it's just the VHS version that has Angelus. I was like, well, because I, you know, as a kid, I was like, Brandon's great. Brandon's the best. I want Brandon. And my friend had a DVD copy. And I'm like, wait, you have a DVD of that? Yeah. Please can I borrow it? He's like, sure. So I finally go watch it. I'm like, yes, here we go, Brandon. And then I hear,
it was a sunny day on the island of Sodor, and all the engines were...
Thomas betrayed us!
But nowadays, I've come to accept him and actually find his narration okay. Quite great, in fact. As a matter of fact, I'd say he's probably better than Baldwin.
Speaking of Baldwin, we're looking at Series 5 Baldwin this time.
Yeah, make someone happy.
The reason why this release is on here is because it tends to be the weakest of the Series 5 releases.
Yes. Compared to the others being Cranky Bugs, Spills and Chills, and Races, Rescues, and Runaways.
And technically you can count Trackside Tunes, but even then, eh.
Trackside Tunes just only really features one new Series 5 episode, and that's mostly consists of songs.
Oh man, the songs.
Series 5.
Hailed by many as the best series in the show.
I consider it probably the best of the series as a whole. I think Series 5 is probably the best, yeah.
It was he has two, like, title cards.
Percy or Oliver should do it. I'm too
that
important.
Fade out of the music. Thomas was cross.
Oh, please. Being important is the only thing for me to think about. Huh.
So, look, I don't consider Baldwin to be the worst narrator, really. At least in this season, for sure.
His name's Tiger Moth.
My mum likes Baldwin's Oliver voice when I showed her the episode.
You help me break, and you'll keep my freight cars in order when we go down hills. I know, Mr. Oliver, but it would be so exciting to go forward for a change instead of only seeing things sliding away from me.
So Topham Hat wants us to pick up. Also, yeah, I love this pairing. I wish I saw this more often.
Oliver and Percy are an underrated duo.
What's the matter? Asked James Driver.
You kick me up the ass.
I'm here on a flying visit. Hurry aboard, Mrs. Kindly, and fly the sky with me.
I kind of do like Baldwin's idea of like the pilots, the Herald's having pilot speak. Like, all right, we're making our descent into the island of Sodor.
I appreciate Baldwin in this series. Personally, myself, I'm not a fan, but I can appreciate him in Series 5.
Good morning.
Goodbye. Good night.
Honestly, this is a fine episode to talk over because it's not a bad episode. But what else? What's there really to talk about?
This is similar to kind of It's Only Snow. I remember liking this a lot more as a kid. But unlike It's Only Snow, I'm still enjoying myself.
Best of all, Sir Topham Hatt invited her to make the announcement.
I'm allergic to carnival food!
But she just faints.
Yeah, she just faints or like doesn't like the roller coasters.
No, she faints on the carousel and is just spinning.
Oh god, so when her corpse is on the carousel?
Oh yeah, the carousel goes out of control.
Stop this crazy thing!
Oh, that's a result. As long as I can make someone happy. He was feeling
bored and lonely. Also, what's with the delay on the title card there?
Oh yeah. Cheer up, Percy. Percy's face looks like it's about to fall off.
Percy, green and small. He's no use to us at all. Around the yards he'll puff and blow, but on the hills he's oh so slow.
He cannot sing.
Yeah, I prefer the other version.
Percy, green and small. He's no use to us at all. Around the yards he'll puff and blow, but on the hills he's oh so slow.
Has he ever sang in anything?
What, Baldwin?
Yeah.
Probably in a movie, I don't know.
A man is named Dennis, imagine a Venice, a wacko who's totally whacked. Oh, it's a way to spend the day pretending.
I'm Julie Andrews.
I'm bored.
Yeah, this is another release as a kid I never had, so I never knew these episodes existed except for Triple Trees.
How were things, asked Toby. Boring.
Boring.
The freight cars were still grumbling.
I like the sets here. I like the kind of the environment here.
See, as a kid, I always thought the coal was boring.
Oh, I was gonna say coffee powder.
Percy angrily.
Also, yeah, we don't see this set in any of the episodes, do we?
No.
No, we don't.
I will say this is definitely an underrated episode in terms of the series.
Oh, yeah. Well, in terms of classic era, yeah.
Because I see no one talk about this episode.
Then we'll just have to stop them, won't we?
I love how the Fat Controller gets involved.
Yeah, and he just takes charge like, then we'll just stop them, won't we? And the way the music then just swells too, just to...
Exactly. It's just my railway, and I take care of my engines, and I also take care of their shafters, well... I love the runaway theme in this episode. Right
down to a yeah, it's great. What did you think? Also, I keep forgetting Birdie has a third wheel in front of him.
But yeah, that was Surprise Percy.
That's great.
Yeah,
that's
great episode.
Love it.
The
engines on
the island of Sodor. Ooh, it's a good one. Time.
Awesome. Nice day for it, isn't it? I've forgotten
about the good luck package for the bride. Hey, you know what? Pops to Baldwin, he at least remembers to keep the silly voice.
I've forgotten about the good luck package for the bride.
My sister has rung to tell me she can't come to stay with me.
Whoa, we never see that load on a flatbed again.
No, we don't. Suddenly we saw
a freight car. No, guys, it's the magic buffers. Cannon!
Oh, no. Mrs. Kindly's chosen you
to be her special guest. Hooray.
Actually, imagine if she didn't invite Percy, and it's like, I did all this fucking work and you won't let me come to the wedding? Bitch.
When the bride and groom... Oh, I like that combination of the two, like, wedding themes. Something old, something new,
something borrowed, something blue. Where'd he get all that crap from?
Also, it didn't dawn on me until I was watching this episode a while ago. Miss Kindly's back there. So is the storyteller, too. And she kissed Percy. And the groom's like, hey, you cheating on me already?
She dumped me for a tray.
This engine's
living my life.
Let it go, Kenny.
When will this nightmare end?
Wait, I just had a realization. So Thomas is part of the good luck package, right? Does that mean Mrs. Kindly's daughter owns Thomas now?
Yeah, Thomas is now private engine, just like Spencer.
Is a private engine?
Show anymore. It's a private engine.
Thomas the Tank. It's the British spelling, even though it's not that like that on the back of the box.
Man, they use this shot a lot, don't they?
Yeah.
Teacher says the sand. I'm so happy it's closed. I hate the playground. Please help us, Thomas. Everyone's upset except this kid.
I love this version of Thomas's theme.
It is great. I was just about look at that milk tanker. Harold just comes in for attack.
Harold just like clips Gordon's cab. Harold
can't fly through tunnels. Oh, yeah. Not every voice of Baldwin's is great.
Gordon and Henry in particular.
Gordon I can tolerate. Henry is just you.
No.
He's counting how many fucks he'll gets. See how useful I... But solving the mystery of Harold and the visitor. I don't know why, but Harold was gonna crash into the shed. Just boom.
Whee! Bang. Gordon was traveling to collect his train. Why did you go that far? Isn't it? Oh wait, that's right. Napfer doesn't exist in this season. It's called Lady Kirk Ronan.
Fart.
I'm sorry, just the speed of that explosion is just funny to me. Thomas her
top of hat it's laugh. The meme. Well, the engines are wrong, and you shouldn't listen to rumors. That's not what they said. This gentleman is making that's a not new the playground meme. For the children.
It was easier to find a suitable site for I was going to say it's the vet, but it's not.
That's Inspector Gadget.
Brown bricks.
And Minecraft. Sand we found
by accident, you might say. Okay, I'm just gonna say the UK line made more sense.
Oh, yeah.
Found by accident and rumor, you might say.
Henry! Great episode.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah, it's okay. It's alright.
Isn't that like Thomas's only spotlight? This is Thomas's only real spotlight episode this year. And it's not even truly, truly about him.
You said this year, this took 2 years to make.
Thomas the Tank. I love this episode.
Yeah! The little blue engine
was covered in coal dust. Look at these shots.
Yeah, the storm feel is so good.
I love this aesthetic. Bothers. It's been like
this all day. That's a good clip. Thomas, you're not
a pleasant sight. I like how Percy was across there, like sticking up for Thomas. Love that.
Yeah. Thomas.
Underrated crash.
Yeah. You should be careful,
James. Trees can be just as powerful. Also, it's the only Terrence line, right?
Isn't it?
Oh, that's right.
Yeah!
Literally in the same release. I completely forgot.
Also, yeah, this is bottom of Gordon's Hill.
Oh. But James. That's not the express. By the
time he arrived, yeah, the atmosphere had
changed. I know, right? Worse.
Your color's nice, James. Pity about your face, though.
I want to use that so bad to bully James the kid. Ignore them and set off. Just to fire back at them, but nah, never worked.
It just ended up being cringe. Yeah, I used to do the same thing too.
Hit the tree. See, I could see that happening in real life. Maybe not like this tree still staying upright, but
whoa, James jump scare.
Yeah. Oh God, it's always as a kid.
James felt embarrassed and worried that Thomas would laugh at him, but Thomas didn't.
If this was a hit era episode, Thomas would definitely have teased James.
Yeah, Thomas and the fireworks display.
I was about to say Thomas and the fireworks display. I think this episode defines Series 5.
Oh, definitely.
In summer.
Ah! Yeah, this one's just okay.
Come on, Percy, said his driver.
I like glitter.
That glows.
Please, sir. Sir Thomas. Seagulls.
Fuck!
Also, nice continuity with special letter being of Duck being podium.
I like how Gordon was the only one that whistled.
On the way, Percy saw Harold.
Harold again!
Why is it?
Are these leftover episodes, or are these actually kind of thought out and put together?
I've got just the ticket to get him off the track, cried the fireman.
Food!
Percy arrived.
Also, yeah, isn't this like first appearance of Maythwaite?
I believe so.
Don't you guys keep forgetting that Maythwaite's not an Audrey station? Technically, Marthwaite is, but not Maythwaite.
Time for a snooze, he thought.
Me after watching Learns a Lesson.
Flowers were scattered everywhere.
No, it looks like what's that Beatles album?
Strawberry Peppers?
Oh, Sergeant Peppers, yeah.
We'll put everything back.
Well, you'll put back all the flowers. The span of what?
A few days later.
Exactly.
It took you days to clean it up?
Okay, so fun fact that I figured out upon watching this, intentional or not, are all the vehicles present at this party here are all the characters on the Season 5 releases in America. Thomas, Percy, Toby, James, and Harold.
The wind from his blades blew Sir Topham Hatt's hat off.
My hat is missing. Thank you for returning my hat. Without my hat, I am lost.
Wait, do you have a song?
It's a music video.
Oh, yeah.
Great to be an engine, yeah. But then again, is the music video separate from the...
Yes.
Great to be an engine, solid song. I love It's Great to Be an Engine.
It's Great to Be an Engine always pissed me off, because why can't be a train? Stop mocking me.
Well, that would make someone happy.
Honestly, I think it's pretty good.
Yeah, it's solid. It's all right. It's all right. Yeah.
If anything, the title episode is really the only dud.
Well, kind of, yeah.
Not even dud, really.
Not really a dud. Well, the episodes themselves, I wouldn't describe Make Someone Happy as a dud. It's just more it's kind of just there kind of thing. Bar, it's all right. Even Thomas and Rumors, it was all right. I think the standout episodes on this one were Surprise for Percy and Trouble with Trees.
Absolutely.
And that's the thing, too. This was supposed to be more of the slice of life down-to-earth episodes of 5, which I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing. Because a lot of what Season 5 does with its more grounded stories, I don't think they're that bad. I think most of us remember, of course, Happy Ever After. I mean, it's a fun scene of a good luck package, I mean.
Right.
And I mean, besides, it gave us a nice day for it, isn't it? The thing is, though, is, it's not the selection of episodes you think of most often when associated with Series 5. And the thing is, too, is I think the main reason we picked it is because next to its competition, it doesn't have the same punch.
Exactly. Make Someone Happy falls into the same category as Percy Saves the Day. Because when you compared Percy Saves the Day to the likenesses of New Friends for Thomas, Hooray for Thomas, and Thomas and the Really Brave Engines, it's kind of the weakest in some ways. And Make Someone Happy definitely kind of feels like that when compared to Cranky Bug, Spills and Chills, and Races, Rescues, and Runaways.
My two cents on it is, yes, it is the lesser of the greats of Series 5, because I think a lot of people don't say this a lot, but I feel like we're kind of spoiled with Series 5, if you know what I mean.
You mean with how good it is, you mean?
Yes. So the expectation of it being so great, and then you have this release where it's still good, but it's not as good as the other ones, I'd say.
It's kind of in the UK, it's kind of like Peep Party in a way, but I feel like with Peep Party, I feel like it's a little bit better because I think the episode selection is a tad bit better.
It has Busy Going Backwards, which is my favorite.
Yeah, it has episodes like Busy Going Backwards, Thomas Percy Knowles, Slow Coach, and Double Teething Troubles, and Lady Has Birthday Party.
See, I think what it is one of those where the hard hitters were kind of all grouped into their own release, leaving the last of the still really good ones kind of just on their own with the slightly slower paced, not quite action-packed ones of 5.
Right.
Hmm.
It's not bad. It's like pairing amazing to great.
Yeah.
But is it something I'd be ashamed to say, yeah, I watched Make Someone Happy today? No, I would not be ashamed to say that.
No.
I'd be ashamed to watch Learns a Lesson again.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
I'll just say, as a rating as a whole, I know it sounds cheesy because James is on the front, but honestly, I'd give this a 5 out of 10. It's Great Green Engine's a good song. James and Trouble with Trees and Surprise for Percy are great episodes. Make Someone Happy's alright, and the other three are just, yeah, they're good. They're good. They're not groundbreaking, but they're good.
So I guess where would you rank this overall?
Personally, I would rank this above Thomas's Snowy Surprise, but probably under Percy Saves the Day.
See, where I'd put it, I guess I'd probably put this above Percy Saves the Day and under New Friends for Thomas.
So as a out of 10?
I'm going to say I'd give it a 7 out of 10.
For me? Well, I'm going to throw a curveball and say this is the best one, and it's going above New Friends.
Fuck.
The reason why I'm saying this is because I'm going to say it's a 5 out of 5. What I like about it is the fact, the tone of it, like, it's warm.
Ultimately, the film is about family.
It's true.
The late great
Mrs. Kindly.
It's about family, and that's what's so powerful about it.
It feels nice, and it feels like you're watching Thomas.
And I think that's a huge thing about it.
You know what, Percy? Fuck it, you're right. I'm changing my vote. I'm giving Make Someone Happy an 8 out of 10, and I'm placing it above New Friends.
Yeah.
I'm still saying New Friends is better. And I'm not saying that because it's Angelus.
I'll say why I changed my votes. It just dawned on me too. Make Someone Happy doesn't have any duds.
I'm not too keen on Thomas and the Rumors myself. Like, it's a bit clunky. I'm not calling it a dud, it's just like a little bit of a dud, so yeah.
That's fair.
Actually, you know what? It doesn't sting as much as Peace and Quiet. So honestly, yeah, I'd change that. Make Someone
I'm very neutral with this tape.
Yeah, we're all gonna agree that Make Someone Happy is definitely the best of the worst of Thomas and Friends.
It's like 12 Angry Men. We're all changing our opinions.
You know what? It ends with a better song. It's Great to Be an Engine's a fucking good song.
It is. It really is. So let's run it back here real quick.
Run it back here. Out of the 8 releases we've got, so at the top of the list we have Make Someone Happy. We agree to that?
Yep.
Then it is New Friends for Thomas.
Yep.
Followed by Percy Saves the Day.
Yep.
Thomas's Snowy Surprise.
Yep.
James Learns a Lesson.
Yeah.
Steamies versus Diesels.
Mm-hmm.
Percy's Chocolate Crunch.
Yeah.
And James and the Red Balloon. Ugh. You know, it's kind of poetic in a way when you realize that the top of the list is James on the cover and the bottom of the list also has James on the cover.
Yeah, isn't James in the middle too?
Yeah! Holy shit, what the fuck?
Oh my god!
He represents the best, he represents the worst, and he represents mid.
Mid.
And this time I said mid!
Hooray!
Mid!
So basically what we're saying is the character that defines everything in terms of Thomas and Media is none other than James.
That's James. So yeah, I guess we watched some decent ones this time.
Exactly.
I will say though, I mean, in comparison to other parts of this franchise, there are better releases.
Exactly.
Especially with James Learns a Freaking Lesson.
Fuck you. You're cool. And fuck you, I'm out.
Hey, you know what? I'd say maybe we can do some more middle of the road releases in the future. Maybe some more bad ones.
We actually could.
My friends. We'll get to the UK.
We thought it would be fun, but it wasn't. We'll put everything back.
Oh, we were right there, man!